Hi, let's talk about the cutaneous innervation of the face. In this video, we'll discuss the dermatomes of the face and head, the divisions of the trigeminal nerve which serve these dermatomes, and branches from each of these divisions. So here you're looking at a left lateral view of a head, and the blue dotted lines represent the boundaries between the various dermatomes of the head. A dermatome is a region of skin which is afferently served by a single nerve. And it's probably best to also note that there is some overlap between sensory innervations of adjacent dermatomes. Now, the face is afferently served by the trigeminal nerve. Tri 3, geminal meaning identical, from gemini meaning twins. So this nerve has three branches to it. They are the ophthalmic nerve, which is also known as V1, the maxillary nerve, known as V2, and the mandibular nerve, known as V3. You may recall that there's a mnemonic for remembering how these nerves exit the skull, and that mnemonic is standing room only. So ophthalmic exits through the superior orbital fissure to serve the orbit and adjacent areas. Maxillary nerve exits through the foramen rotundum, the round window, moves anteriorly to serve the deep midface. And V3 leaves through foramen ovale, the oval-shaped window, to descend down into the infratemporal fossa to serve muscles of mastication and afferently serve the jaw region. There are also branches from cervical spinal nerves which afferently serve the head. So you notice this region here of the posterior head is served by dorsal primary rami of cervical nerves. And this region here is served by branches of the cervical plexus. Those are the nerve or herbs point of the neck afferents, which we discussed in an earlier session. The remaining three dermatomes belong to V1, V2, and V3. So the boundary between V1 and V2 starts out at the tip of the nose, and it moves back, arcing laterally, till it almost reaches the lateral sulcus of the nose, just above the alar region, where it ascends to the medial canthus of the eye, moves laterally across the palpebral fissure, and then arcs superior-posteriorly across the temporal region, all the way back to the posterior aspect of the cranium. The boundary between V2 and V3 begins at the angle of the mouth, and it moves posteriorly back until almost reaching the masseter, and then it arcs nearly straight up superiorly until it runs into the boundary between V1 and V3. So, V1, V2, and V3 for the face. And these patterns are going to be clinically useful in one particular instance, and that is when an individual has a herpes zoster infection. So with herpes zoster, it's shingles, or reactivated chickenpox virus that is usually latent in the spinal nerves, but when reactivated, it begins to present as itchy blisters that follow the dermatomes. And so the dermatomes of the face are good to know, because one might presume to understand the course of a herpes infection. So let's take a look at some of these branches, and let's start with the ophthalmic division, V1. Now, for the orbit and the eye, V1 is going to be the star of the show in terms of nerves. But for the face, we're really limiting ourselves here to the terminal branches of the frontal nerve. The frontal nerve is here, and it's running across the roof of the orbit. So this here is the eye. Here is lateral. Here is medial, and medial also works for this photograph as well. That's medial, and that's lateral. And so this would be a superior view of the orbit, and this would be a anterior view of the orbit with the palpebrae approximated. So here's the frontal nerve moving across the roof of the orbit, and its two terminal branches medially are the supratrochlear nerve and laterally the supraorbital nerve. And that supraorbital nerve usually splits into a medial and a lateral branch. And these are destined to leave the orbit. And let's turn our attention to the anterior view here and see where they're going. So here is the supraorbital nerve, and it's exiting out the supraorbital foramen here. Sometimes this is just a notch, but here we've got a good foramen. And the supraorbital nerve is the more robust of the two, and it's the more laterally situated. And the supraorbital nerve is responsible for sensory innervation of the lateral forehead, the lateral aspect of the superior palpebrae, and lateral aspect of the superior conjunctiva. We also can see here the supratrochlear nerve. Supratrochlear nerve is getting its name because it's exiting the skull just adjacent to the trochlea, which is a little pulley for the superior oblique muscle there. And this supratrochlear nerve is responsible for sensory innervation to the medial forehead, the medial superior eyelid, and medial superior conjunctiva of the eye. And it is a little more diminutive. Now, to give you a preview of what dreams may come in the next slide, we also have here the infraorbital foramen and the infraorbital nerve traveling out the infraorbital foramen. And you might notice here is the orbit, supraorbital above the orbit, infraorbital below the orbit. And these two, not exactly in a linear plane, superior to inferior, but they're pretty close, pretty close. So here is the image that we were looking at just before. So here is the lateral aspect of the eye. Here is the medial aspect of the eye. The bridge of the nose is running down like so. Supraorbital nerve, supratrochlear nerve, and the infraorbital nerve exiting through the infraorbital foramen to serve the skin of the superficial midface. Good old V2. The mandibular division, or V3, if you recall, descends down through foramen ovale, and as it comes down, it's in a wonderful region that you'll come to love and appreciate, known as the infratemporal fossa. Infratemporal fossa is where V3 lives and from where it emanates. And there are a couple of major nerves that are exiting through here. There's lots to be excited about as a healthcare professional, especially as a dental healthcare professional. But let's take these one at a time. So here is the main trunk of V3 coming down. And moving off posteriorly, I'm going to outline this just because it is that cool. Got one branch there and one branch there. You notice this originates from that main trunk here as a fork before coming together and then moving just anterior to the ear and spreading out over this posterior aspect of the temporal region. This is known as the auriculotemporal nerve. The auriculotemporal nerve is going to encircle the middle meningeal branch of the maxillary artery. That's a great way to identify auriculotemporal. Middle meningeal is coming off the maxillary artery and it's ascending into the cranium. It's one of the few vessels that aren't of, it's the only vessel that isn't of either the internal carotid artery or the vertebral artery that's entering into the cranium to serve something. And so there's that classic anatomical relationship that we look for. We'll also learn about how postganglionic branches, postganglionic parasympathetic branches that serve the parotid gland. And the parotid gland is going to be located superficially there in the parotid fossa, are carried by the auriculotemporal nerve. And the ganglion, the otic ganglion, is deep to the trunk of V3 there. And so it's not too far for those fibers to hitchhike. But here's auriculotemporal serving that posterior aspect of the temporal region. We also have another interesting sensory nerve called the buccal nerve. Some folks like to call it the long buccal so that we don't confuse it with the buccal branches of the facial nerve. But this is the afferent for the cheek region. And here we can see the buccinator muscle. That wonderful muscle that brings foodstuffs into the occlusal surfaces of the teeth. And then finally here, we can see the mental nerve, which is the terminal branch of the inferior alveolar nerve, the IAN. The inferior alveolar nerve is the sensory nerve to the mandible and the mandibular teeth, and it is a major target for an anesthetic block called an IAN block for when you're working on mandibular teeth. Anyways, here is that terminal branch of IAN coming out to innervate the mental region or the chin region. So that leads us to our assessment question, and that is shingles is a reactivated infection of herpes zoster or varicella zoster. It can manifest as painful blisters along the dermatomes served by infected nerves. A shingles infection that is affecting the superior eyelid is indicative of which nerve being involved. Let's see, buccal nerve. Well, buccal is a V3 branch, so that's a mandibular nerve, probably not. Inferior alveolar nerve, that's a V2. Maxillary, probably not. V2, maxillary division, probably not. Nope. V3, maxillary division, nope, most certainly not. Ophthalmic nerve, V1. Yes, serving the orbit and periorbital vicinity is the correct answer. Thank you very much for your time.